If you got your Bibles, go to John chapter number 11. Last week we studied out of 1 Samuel chapter number 3 about the call of Samuel. We introduced a message last week on God's four calls. I feel compelled to go on with that tonight. I love what the Lord's given me tonight, and I hope I can communicate it to you. Turn to John chapter number 11, and when you get there, say amen. Amen. I want you to look at verse number 22, and I just want to take you, let's go to verse 20. And let me take you down to verse number 28, and I'll deal with 28. But let's set the context. Lazarus has died. It has now been 4 days. There was great grief in the family. There was a belief in the family. I want to say this to you. There was a belief in that family that the Lord could heal. But they had not got to the place in their faith that they believed he could resurrect somebody from the dead. That's where we're at in this story. And by the way, the Lord knew he was going to die. Amen. And by the way, he waited till he did die. I'm glad I got a God that can bring to life from dead things. Hey, there's a bunch of churches tonight could take a little bit of idea from that. They're dead and dried up, no evangelism, no power in their church, no soul being saved, nothing happening. They're dead. They need life. And this will help them tonight. So with that in mind, let's look down verse 20. Then Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, went and met him. This is John 11 and verse 20. But Mary sat still in the house. Then said Martha unto Jesus, Lord. Now notice the extent of her faith. If thou hast been here, my brother had not died. They really believed he would heal them. But I know that even now, whatsoever thou wilt ask of God, God will give it thee. And Jesus saith unto her, thy brother shall rise. Now, she had some doctrine about her, okay? By the way, there's a bunch of liberals out there and a bunch of churches out there that don't want to preach doctrine. By the way, doctrine is no more than teaching. You know, a lot of interdenominational churches, a lot of stuff, and they said, we don't preach doctrine. No, that's not a bit the truth. They just preach all kinds of it. Good preaching, Reverend. Verse 23, Jesus saith unto her, thy brother shall rise. Martha said, now listen, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection of the last day. I'm getting shouting ground here. Then Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believeth thou this? By the way, it's gospel right now. You're dead in sin. If you believe tonight that Jesus died, was buried, and rose again, tonight you could be a child of God. Amen. Whew, glory. And I'm going to tell you, God won't put you on probation either. You're saved forever. She saith unto him, I'm going somewhere, just stay with me. These verses are so thrilling. Yea, Lord, I believe that thou art the Christ, the Son of God, which should come into the world. And when he had said so, she went her way and called Mary, her sister, secretly saying, the Master has come and calleth for thee. I'm glad that God's call is a personal call. Now, last week, And I won't re-preach it, but I want to give it to you. We had a call from above. That's threefold. That's a call unto salvation. Come unto me, all ye that labor and heavy laden. By the way, salvation isn't in the Baptist church. Salvation isn't in a denomination. Salvation is in a person. You don't come unto the preacher. Hey, you don't go get some Hail Marys and somebody to pray you in. You come by faith to Jesus alone and trust him. Come unto me. That's salvation. Then come out from among them. That's separation. By the way, some of my Baptist brethren, they take it to extreme. Then some of the liberals take it to extreme. But I believe we are separated unto God. You ever get saved on the inside, it'll start showing forth on the outside. And then the call from above includes salvation. Come unto me. Involves separation. Come out from among them. Involves service. Come after me. For, ladies and gentlemen, God wants every one of you to serve him. I'm asking you not to follow me, though I think you ought to follow me as I follow Christ. That's the Bible. But I'm asking you to take up your cross and follow him. Now, secondly, that got our introduction and got us back to where we were last week. If you got your Bible, I'll give you the last three calls. Turn to 2 Corinthians 5:10. When you get there, holler amen. Well, one, two, anybody else? Three. 2 Corinthians 5:10, say amen back there. Amen. Thank you. See, not only, Brother Tim, do I have a call from above, but we have a call from within. Look what the Word of God says. In 2 Corinthians 5, I think it's 5:10. Wait a minute. Hold on a minute. I'm messing up. Y'all ever done that? Thank you. Just stay with me. I may be a book or two away from it. You know what I mean. Where am I at? Okay, let me quote the verse. And somebody find it in this chapter for me. For the love of Christ constraineth us. 14, thank you. 5:14, 2 Corinthians 5:14. For the love of Christ constraineth us, because we thus judge that if one die for all, then we're all dead. Ladies and gentlemen, that's the call from within. Now, that's a twofold call, Doug. First of all, there's an implication for the sinner. And I want to say this tonight. Salvation does not start on the outside. It starts on the inside. I really think some of my Baptist brethren got this wrong. They're preaching a lordship salvation. They're preaching you fix up the outside, and that's okay. Ladies and gentlemen, God doesn't work from the outside in. He works from the inside out. Amen. And the Bible said, hope maketh not ashamed. Romans 5:5. Because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost which is given us. Now listen to this. This is a good preacher right here. I want you to know something. There is a crowd out there that believe you get the Holy Ghost after you go through some kind of process. I want to tell you, you get the Holy Ghost. It is a result of justification. You get the Holy Ghost. He comes in your heart the moment you get saved. I want you to know something. That Holy Spirit's the one that gives you a want to be saved. Now I'm gonna make a statement here, kind of big. Somebody made a statement, asked me this question, does God save me against my will? Absolutely not. But I tell you what he does. He makes you willing to be saved. And that's not by the human intellect, That is by the work of the Holy Ghost in your heart, trying to convince you that you're a sinner, trying to convince you that you're lost, and that love of Christ constrains you to walk down the aisle and trust Christ as Savior. But hold a minute. That's not all. That's to the sinner. But also the love of Christ constrains a saint. The greatest motivation for serving God is from the love of God that's in your heart. Amen? The love of Christ constrains me. You said, why do you pick up more missionaries? And why are you constantly pressing? And why do you make such a fervent call to get sinners saved at every service that we have? Because the love of Christ on my inside is reaching and reaching and compelling me to try to get people saved. Amen. Amen. Greatest motivation to walk for God is the love of Christ. Amen. But I'm going to give y'all something. Write this one down. This will help you. There's sometimes we quench the Lord a little bit. How many of y'all love God? But how many of you, sometimes it's not as passionate as other times? What do you do then? What do you do then? I got the answer. Ecclesiastes says this: the whole duty of man is to fear God and keep his commandments. I want to tell you, Doug, Jack House preached one of the greatest sermons I ever heard on duty. I'm not preaching it, but can I tell you something? If your love is not as strong tonight as it has been, I pray tonight that you'll yield to the Holy Spirit and that'll get big again. But let me tell you what you do until it gets big again. You serve God anyhow. You preach anyhow. You say, well, I'm not emotional. I'm not filled up. I don't even feel like it. I don't care if you feel like it or not. You do it anyhow out of duty. Here's what I believe. There is times in my Christian life, how about y'all? Or some of y'all just, it don't happen for you. That I don't have the goosebumps. I don't have the passion all the time. You say, when you don't have it, what do you do? I keep asking for it, but hey, I'm still gonna do what I'm supposed to do. I might be fighting hell by an anchor, but I'm not going to let God have my second best. I'm going to give him my best. I'm going to give him out of duty do my best until that love starts motivating me. And by the way, friend, you don't have to serve him much out of duty until that love starts springing back up. You want to give something, give him because you love God. You want to help somebody, do it because you love God. You want to keep people out of hell, do it because you love God. That ought to motivate you tonight. Whew. There is something within me and you. By the way, I'm going to say it like this. If you're saved, you ain't no different than me. You got the same Holy Ghost I do. And he's in you, and he ought to be affecting you. And I come to this point, a lot of times I wonder if he's in, because I ain't seeing much effect of it. Good preacher, Reverend. Listen to me, he's in me. That's a driving force in my life. The Holy Spirit in me, the love of God in me. I thank God the church pays me. Y'all get a payday? I can tell you this. That is not my motive. That's just an end to a means. That's your duty to do anyhow. And our staff and take care of it. But hey, I wouldn't give you a nickel for a preacher or a layman or anybody else that's serving God if they don't have Christ within them, motivating them. There's a love from above and there's a love from within. There's a call from above and there's a call from, there's just something about me. I got something in me that makes me keep on pressing, keep on going. I had one of my preacher friends asked me the other day, he said, when are you going to be 66? I said, a year from July. He said, are you retiring? I said, if I'm dying, maybe I will. I mean, you know, if they pronounced me 6 months to live or something. I said, but not really. How can I do that when I got something pushing me? I've got a couple more years left to plague you people. You know what? I'll tell you this. I'm in my 60s, and to be honest with you, I feel more in gear in my 60s than I ever did in my 50s or 40s or 30s. The only thing I don't have going good is my body. That's why I got Humpty Dumpty there and his little brother back there. Now, by the way, ask him if I don't keep up with him. I still push it. But if I get tired, I'm going to keep on going. Man, why quit in your prime? I was crazy in my 30s and 40s. By the way, you needed a crazy pastor back then. Number three. Turn to Acts 16. Oh, Lord. Turn to Acts 16, please. Let me give you a third call. This is I want you to see this. Acts 16, if you're there, say amen. Go down with me to verse number 8. Now, I want y'all to understand something. Doug, I think I'm right here. You help me. Paul, at this moment, was heading toward Asia. He was heading toward Asia. Asia Minor is where he's heading. But listen what happened. Look in verse number 8. And they passing by Mysia came down to Troas. Listen to this. And a night vision appeared to Paul in the night. There stood a man of Macedonia and prayed him, saying, come over into Macedonia and help us. That's the famous Macedonian call. But ladies and gentlemen, there's some of you really don't know the impact of that. So I'm going to give it to you. He was going toward Asia and China. And God said, go west, young man. And he went to Macedonia. And his westward move, then the gospel got to England. And then they left England and came to America. You said, where did it all begin? It didn't begin just with a Mayflower. Number three, it began from a call from without. Hey, you're going that way. I believe God's with you, but we need you over here. And God woke him up in that vision, and that man spoke to him. And Paul turned around and went west, and Paul preached the gospel. And United States citizen, you're saved tonight because of the obedience of Paul to follow God. Amen. That's enough to make one of Baptists want to shout. There's a call from without. I can say this about my total staff. Now, I tease them all the time. We're motivated by something. There's a call outside. And by the way, I want to tell you something we're doing at Easter. Since we've hired our multimedia specialist, Allison's doing a great job. Can I tell you, she made up 15,000 He Is Risen mailers, mail outs. on the 15,000 mail outs, it's announcing our Easter service, our three dramas, all the 255-26s, and all the 255-60s are going to get an Easter invitation to Taze Valley Baptist. And to our dramas and to our church service on Sunday morning. You say, why the effort? Because that crowd out there needs us. The drug addicts need us. The moral man needs us. The rich man needs us. The poor man needs us. The black man needs us. The white man needs us. The Asian needs us. Everybody needs the gospel. And we need to reach everybody we can, so we're making an all-out thrust. You say, well, what if 15,000 come that weekend? We just praise God for it. We'll do what we can. Now, if I had to preach five times on Easter Sunday morning, buddy, we'll do her. We'll start her at 7 o'clock in the morning and preach her all the way up. Listen to me. There's a call from out. There's people. There are people in Kenya. There's people in Jamaica. There's people down in Grenada. There's people in Europe and France and Germany and in the UK. They're reaching out. They're saying, come over here. We need the truth. Tell you what still motivates me. There's somebody out there that said, come here. I was over to the hospital this weekend. I met somebody else over there, and I think it was Monday or Tuesday. I was there to see other folks, but I walked into the ICU and I couldn't get back yet. And so I sit down, and this young lady, about 21, she was crying. I said, honey, what's happening? She said, my mama's dying. I said, you saved? Is she saved? I go back and witness her. She said, oh, mama's saved. She said, I'm saved, but I'm not a very good Christian right now. I'm backsliding. Well, I tell you what I've done. That's one of them calls from without. I just sat down, told her in the Bible how to get that joy back. She wept and cried and asked God just to restore her joy. You said, how's that happen for you? If you got your eyes on eternity and you got your eyes on people, there are people screaming for help. Right now, our frontline ministry, where we're dealing with drug addicts and folks that's addicted to all kinds of stuff, pornographic stuff and drugs, alcohol, gambling. That thing's on the rise right now. That ministry went from nothing 18 months ago. And we're steadily having 45 to 55 every Saturday. You say, why you have it on Saturday? Because that's when that crowd runs around. We want to have it on the devil's night. Amen. And we love it on the devil's night when one of them walks the aisle and gets saved. Amen. We love it on the devil's night when they stay sober and come to Sunday school the next day, then walk down the aisle in this church that you see many of them doing. I tell you, there's people out there that need the gospel. People really do need the Lord. I want to give you one more. I have two more after this, but I'm going to just give you one more. These are the main four. Turn to Luke 16. I want you, if you're here lost, I want you to be sure to hear this part. Luke 16, are you there? Say amen. Verse 19. There was a certain rich man which was clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day. And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, which was laid at the gate full of sores and desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked the sores. And it came to pass that the beggar died and was carried by the angels in Abraham's bosom. By the way, Abraham's bosom was paradise that was in the center of the earth until the resurrection. Okay. The rich man also died and was what? And in hell he what? Oh, no, he didn't lift it. He lived. He's still there. It's not a past tense thing. He lifted his eye. He's right there being in torments, and saith Abraham afar off and Lazarus. And he said, cried unto Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. And people that says there's no fire in hell's wrong. But Abraham said, son, remember that thou in thy lifetime received the good things, Lazarus evil things, but now he is comforted and thou art tormented. And besides all this, between you and me, there's a great gulf fixed that they which would pass from hence cannot, and neither can they pass to us that would come from hence. Then he said, listen to this. I pray thee, therefore, Father, that thou wouldest send him to my father's house. Get Lazarus, send him. For I have five brethren that he may testify unto, lest they also come into this place of torment. Abraham said unto them, they have Moses and the prophets, let them hear them. And he said, nay, Father Abraham, but if one went unto them from the dead, they would repent. And he said unto them, if they hear not Moses the prophet, neither will they be persuaded, though one raised from the dead. You know what I got from that? The last call. It's the call from beneath. Hell's calling us. The worst thing can happen to you, young lady, young man, mom, dad, boy or girl, is for you to go to the hell that the rich man went. You know, Curtis Hudson said this. I don't know if many of y'all know this, but Curtis Hudson became one of my great friends at the last year of his life. He dedicated our church. I have three of his ties that I don't do anything with, but just watch them. He made a statement in Taze Valley Baptist Church. He said, the greatest thing could happen if we could just do this is get about five buses and load them up and get you on them and let you run down to the street of the damned. I want to tell you what hell ought to motivate us. Ain't nobody ought to want anybody to go to hell. Amen. And if you're here in this room tonight, I don't want you to go to hell. Dear God, and by the way, you don't have to go to hell because Christ done died for you. But there's a call from beneath. Don't come here. Don't come and be tormented. There's a heaven you can receive by the grace of God, and there's a hell if you reject God. Bow your head with me. Four calls. Heads bowed, eyes closed, nobody looking around. How many of you know if you died tonight, 100%, you'll go to heaven because you trusted Christ? Raise your hand high. Testify a moment. Hold them up for me. Thank you. How many of you could not raise your hand, but you want to go to heaven before you die? And you'll slip it up now and say, pray for me. I'm not sure I'm saved. How many tonight, you haven't been motivated for service and for God like you should be? And tonight, because you've heard about the call from without, and the call from within, and the call from beneath, God spoke to you about winning souls and helping others. How many just raise your hand and say, pray for me. Pray for me.